Thank you very much. And hello, everybody. I hope you're having a great Cambridge Live. Today we're going to look at how to help learners who've fallen behind. And the first thing I want to look at is reasons why they might have fallen behind, because I think there are quite a lot of different reasons. Okay, so it could just be that you've got a mixed ability class and learners are never going to all operate at the same level, at the same speed or anything. And so there are always ones who are going to be further behind others. It may be because they've missed school through COVID, whether they've all missed school or whether individuals have because of illness or something like that. But I think it's really important to remember other things that are going on in students' lives. They may be having difficulties at home that mean that they just can't concentrate. They may have their own mental health issues that are often invisible to us, but again, affect their ability to concentrate. I'm sure some of the students in your classes have specific learning differences. Maybe they have dyslexia or on the autism spectrum, something like that. Or it may just be that they're not very engaged for other reasons. Perhaps it's just the time of their lives or something like that. So I think it's also really important to think what they've fallen behind with. Is it just language? Okay, and it may well be just the language. And if it is the language, is it specific skills? Is it that they've lost their confidence for speaking, perhaps? Or is it specific language points that they just didn't get the first time around, perhaps because they were distracted and they need help with that? But there's a lot beyond language. So maybe their study skills, they've fallen behind with those, and their study habits. Perhaps during the pandemic, they got out of the habit of studying and they need help with that. Perhaps they've kind of forgotten how to concentrate, or they've lost their motivation, or possibly again, through the pandemic, that they've lost their social skills. It could well be that they've spent so much time on their own that they're finding it difficult to cope with. But I think what's really important for us as teachers is to recognise what they're doing well. There might be things they've fallen behind with, but other things that they're doing really well with. And it's always useful to be looking out for those. Okay, how do we find out? How do we find out what they've fallen behind with? And I think there's obviously assessment. I'm sure you do your own types of assessment, and that's going to tell you or indicate particular things that they've fallen behind with. But also, it might give you a general view about their skills and things like that. Something I like to do at the end of a class is a checkout. Some of you might call this exit slips, where the students have to either say something or write something before they leave the class. And so perhaps they have to write something that they've learned or how they feel about the lesson, something like that. And that gives me some kind of indication of how things are going, or something they found difficult, perhaps. Another thing to have in the classroom is a comments box. And I was talking to somebody recently who said that when she started, she had a comments box and told students they could put anything in there, but not many did. But then she changed her tack a little bit and told them that they had to write something. And if they wanted, they could just write, hi, thank you for the lesson, that sort of thing. But then she found the people who did want to say something, say that they were having difficulties, were much more likely to add something to the comment box. So do think about that. So let's just have a look at a couple of ways that they can catch up with work that they've actually missed. And I want to start by looking at the flipped classroom. Okay, this you may be familiar with, is where the students do work at home before the class, not after it. Okay, so they're kind of preparing themselves for the class. So for example, they might be watching a video. It could be a video that explains some grammar or vocabulary or something like that. So almost like a presentation. It could be that they do some reading or some listening, some writing. They familiarize themselves with the exam, all of those sorts of things that they could do before the class. I find it's much better if we give them a task to do. They're more likely to do it, especially if they know that you'll see that they've done it. But also it just gives them that focus. There are a couple of tools that you might find useful that I use. One of them is PlayPosit. You can see PlayPosit here. They watch the video and you can add tasks for them to do. This particular one is a forum and they can write comments at different times within the video. The video will pause. And next time somebody watches it, that comment comes up when they get to that particular point of the video. It's fantastic. Another thing you can do is you can put in questions at particular times in the video and it will stop. So that's PlayPosit. The link is there, and perhaps somebody would kindly put the link into the chat for me. And there's another one which I've used a lot as well, which I really like, called Edpuzzle, which is similar. Okay. So they do the work beforehand for homework, and then in class, they actually use the language. We can take advantage of them being there together. They can use the language they've learned. They can interact with each other and the teacher. And this is where they can ask the teacher for clarification, for feedback, and that's the more human side of it. So that's one thing we can do, is to use the flipped classroom. Another thing is, we hear a lot nowadays about mediation, and we can use mediation as well to help. What do we mean by that? So if we're looking at mediating communication, we're talking about enabling students to help other people communicate when there's some kind of obstacle, you know, and that obstacle can be that a student has missed a certain lesson or is a different level, speaks English at a different level. So what we're really talking about here is peer-to-peer learning. Okay, so they're learning from each other. And it's become quite a buzzword nowadays, mediation, and you're probably familiar with it from the CEFR, where it's mentioned quite a lot. Let's have a look at a few reasons for using peer-to-peer learning. I think that students have already been through the same process of learning, and they understand each other's problems and difficulties with this particular language. They understand that better than we do sometimes. If like me, you're a native speaker and you've never had to learn the language in that way, there may be things that, you know, I wouldn't know. You have an advantage, really, if you've also had to learn it as a second language, but that might be quite a long time ago. Okay, so I think they're very good at understanding each other's problems. Also, it's very useful for those who are teaching, because when you teach something, you often learn something and it consolidates it in your mind, and you have to be really clear. So I think that's a great way of learning. However, having said that, I think it's very important that we guide students in how to teach each other, and that we check what they're teaching as well. We don't want them teaching something that's completely wrong. Another thing that's really useful is getting students to share study skills and strategies. Those who are doing well may well have some very good study skills that would be useful for those who are struggling a bit. And also, it's such a meaningful thing to do, to teach somebody else something, and it's a very real life skill as well. So great to be practicing that. So how can we use mediation? I'm going to give you an example. Let's say we've got a class and we've got some students who are doing really well and keeping up with the class, and some others who are struggling. They have fallen behind. In this case, you can put them into two groups, and let's say the ones who are doing fine, we'll call them the purple group. We don't want to use anything judgmental, and the others we'll call the green group. And you might want to put some of the ones who are doing well, you might want to put them into the green group as well. Okay, and then we give the purple group, that's the ones who have kind of got it, you feel like they've got it, we're going to give them a task. And their task is to choose a language area. So I would have put some language areas on the board, things that we've studied recently, or you might want to just, might be a particular language area. And they have to work together, work in groups, to decide how they can teach that in a visual way. So they have to make a visual. So it could be a drawing, it could be an infographic, a PowerPoint, a video, it's up to them. But they have to design that, okay? I tell them that they can look at the course book, they can look at other resources if they need to, but they have to agree on what are the most important points and how are they going to put those across, okay? And while they're doing it, they should also include how it's the same or different in their own language, how this piece of language can be used in everyday life, and really important one, any problems they had with learning it and what helped them. Okay, obviously this is what I do. Obviously you change whatever you want to. Meanwhile, what do the others do? We want them to be busy, and we want them not to feel like they're not useful members of the group either. So I give them another task, which is to do the same thing, just about the same thing, but with a real life non-linguistic skill. So maybe they're great at playing the guitar or something, and they might want to show somebody a little bit how they can play something really simple on the guitar. Or what about skateboarding? If they're into skateboarding, what do you have to remember when you're skateboarding? That kind of thing. And then you pair them up. So people from the purple group with the green group, they teach each other. And so the green group are doing just as much teaching, but it's not linguistic. But the purple group are hopefully helping them to catch up. I hope that makes sense. Okay, so those are a couple of ways that we can really try to boost the knowledge that they've missed. But I want to think now about how we can accommodate people who've fallen behind in the class more generally. So one of the things that we can do is to be very clear, okay, and in what we're teaching, to be very clear And so there's as little confusion as possible, and this will help to speed up their understanding. And then, of course, we need to check it. It's really important that we check understanding as well. And we can do that with questions, not do you understand, because they'll probably say yes, even if they don't. You can ask people to explain it back to the class, or you can ask specific concept checking questions. Okay, so do we use this language when we're talking to our friends, or do we use it in a formal situation? Okay, that kind of question. Also, we need to be able to provide support when it's needed. We have to be careful that we're not just testing. We need to be teaching them. And so if they don't know something, they've got to be able to find it. And we'll look at some ideas for that in a minute. We've got to be very aware that people learn at a different pace. And so we need to allow for that in our teaching. And also, I think it's really important to use multi-sensory approaches, and we'll look at some of those in a minute, so that it's not all reliant on language, so people can see things and hear things as well. Now, you may already be thinking, yeah, but this is just good practice. Absolutely. This is good practice for everybody. So you're not doing anything special for those who are falling behind, but this is useful for everybody. Just good teaching strategies. But we need to be more consistent with them. So what we're trying to do is to remove obstacles to learning. So I think, you know, more teaching, less testing. And sometimes things that look like they're teaching are actually testing. So it's always worth asking yourself, am I actually teaching them something here, or am I just testing them on what they're supposed to know? We need to try to build in more flexibility so we can give different students different lengths of tasks. So, you know, if there are 10 questions, some of them can just do 5 questions. And others can do 10. So build that into your learning. Think what's really useful. Is there anything that you do in class that actually is not that useful? It's like when you write something on the board and you tell your students to copy it off the board. Are you doing that for a reason? Maybe. But if not, is there a quicker way to do this? We need more scaffolding, helping them to get to their goal. And we'll look at that in a minute. And more differentiation for different students. If you're not sure about the difference, don't worry, we're coming to that. So let's look at multisensory learning. So we can use multisensory learning for presentations and also for practice activities, like, for example, when we're teaching grammar structures. Here's an example. And this is using Cuisenaire rods, or you might have some bricks or something like that. It's a bit difficult for me to show you here, so I just have to use this graphic. So if you can see, okay. So if we're teaching at a very low level and we've got she likes football, okay, and we want to show that that's a statement, but how do we make the question? Okay, we can show that the S of likes moves on to this auxiliary here. So we've got the same she, like, without the S, and football. And to make it into a yes-no question, we have to add the auxiliary with an S on it. Okay, but that visual really helps them to understand. With the verb to be, you are hungry, and we want to make it into a question, we can show that we're just swapping those. And so we can show that these swap. Okay, and then you can get your students to do their practice in that way as well. What else we can do? The output, what do they have to produce? And it could be that they, for example, they have to make a short video or something like that. They don't always need to be writing and filling in gaps and things like that. So always worth thinking about what else they can do. And with comprehension, you know, again, it's not always answering comprehension questions. It could be that they have to draw what they've understood, for example. Okay, scaffolding and differentiation. There's often a lot of confusion between these two. So let's have a look. So on the left-hand side, some examples of scaffolding. So maybe you provide a glossary of difficult words in a text. You wouldn't want to do that all the time because you want to teach students to guess the meaning of unknown words. But if you think they can't guess or they're particularly difficult, you might want to give them a glossary. And here we're talking about it's available for everybody. I don't know if you're familiar with learning maths. These are sometimes used in primary education, but I think they definitely have a place in secondary education as well. It's really a piece of paper on the table, and it's got reminders of the key points about the language that they're learning. Or a language mat could be an irregular verb, a list of irregular verbs. Okay, so something like that that they can refer to if they need to. Okay, and again, it's available for everybody. Breaking up tasks into smaller chunks. So letting people do one part and then they can move on to the next rather than giving them lots of different instructions at the same time. And again, showing them content visually, or asking them to show content visually. Okay, this often helps them, for example, using a mind map, using a fishbone diagram, something like that. And it helps them to do it step by step. Right, what's the difference between scaffolding and differentiation? Differentiation is just for certain students. Scaffolding is available for everybody. So you might take a text and make it shorter or easier for some of your students. Okay, that would be differentiation. Or you might write some easier questions, the same text, but easier questions for those who can't manage. You might, as I said before, you might tell some students they just need to do 5 of the 10 questions. Or maybe your students have to write 250 words and you tell some of them they can do 100 or 125 words, okay? Or you might ask some students to present their work in a different format, so as a diagram or something like that. So there's not, if their problem is writing, there's not too much writing for them to do. There are loads of different examples, but I hope you see the difference now between scaffolding and differentiation. Scaffolding for everybody, step by step, and differentiation for those who need it. Okay, let's have a look at differentiation. How can we make things easier? Right. So it could be that we use some simpler and more common synonyms. Not where it's the target language, because we want to teach the same target language, but in a text, for example. We may need to use images more. Images really help with understanding, so why not? This is a slightly political one. I know some people are told they must never use the first language in the class, but think about it. Are there times where it would be useful? If you're told you're never allowed to, don't say that I said you could. You do what you need to do. But it's worth giving it consideration. I don't think for teaching, but to enable them to do something. Sometimes that's going to be really useful for some of the students. Also, consider using the recording script sometimes with listening. Again, I wouldn't do it all the time because you don't want them to rely on the audio script. Sometimes you want them just to listen, but the audio script can be really useful. But I would get them to listen first without. And allowing the use of resources like dictionaries and things like that. And also, like if you've got a gap fill, maybe some students don't need the words, they just have to think what the words would be. But for weaker students, they might need to have the options to put in. A few more tips about differentiation. And I think this one is vital, really important. You are aiming for them to learn the same as everybody else. The aim is not for them to complete something and get it right. Okay, it's nice if they get it right, but it should still be challenging and it should still have the same aim. Okay, it's not just about them completing something. So don't make it too easy for them. You always need to bear in mind the learning. I would start and end every lesson with everybody together, just to kind of bond people together, and then you can put them into different groups with different tasks. And I mentioned before naming groups. We don't want to, I try to avoid group A and group B because group A always sounds like it's stronger and things like that. So colours or something like that are good. Okay, how do we group them? I think there are three ways to group people. You could put people who are a similar level together, as I did in my example earlier. And the advantage of that is they really get to work at their level. So there's nothing holding back the stronger ones. And the ones who are trying to catch up or who are struggling a bit, they have time to work together, to work things out together. Alternatively, you could mix up the levels, and there are advantages to that as well, because they learn from each other and they teach each other. So you've got more of that peer-to-peer learning as well. Or do it randomly and see what happens. Very often I do group my students randomly, and it often works out really well. But I would say generally, you know, trying different ways and noticing, as a teacher, noticing the effect of these different types of grouping. Reflecting on that can be really useful. When it comes to plenary work, there are a few hints that I've got for you. And I'm sure you'll be aware of many of these. Very often teachers say, ask a question and say, put up your hand if you've got the answer. There are definitely problems with this. One is that it's nearly always the same people who put up their hands. And then what about the others? What about the people who never put up their hands? Do you ask them anyway? And if you do, that's a bit odd because why are you asking others to put their hands up? And I've also seen research that says that teachers tend to ask boys more than girls. Now, you might not agree with this, but the funny thing was that the research said that the teachers didn't agree even when they did do it. Just something that there are definite reasons not to, at least not to do it all the time, hands up. So what can we do instead? A few things that I would suggest. One is mini whiteboards. I don't know if you use these. I think they're fabulous. And so if you ask a question and your students have got a mini whiteboard, you get them to write the answer on their mini whiteboard and then they all hold them up. And you can see what answer everybody has got. Now, you might be worried about your weaker students, but actually the others are not going to have a lot of time to turn around and see. What I sometimes do is get them to write their answers. They can write that quite privately. And then I say, 1, 2, 3, show me, and everybody holds them up. Okay, I can look around quickly, see how people are doing, and then they're down. Okay, so that's one way to do it. And that's great because you get answers from everybody and you can see then who's falling behind. Another way to do it is by using lollipop sticks, or the Americans call them popsicle sticks with names on. Here's an example of some lollipop sticks with, so here the teacher has got the students to write their names on them. And what you do is turn them upside down when you've got the names on, put them in a pot, and then you can nominate randomly. So I might take one out and I say, okay, Judith, can you tell me the answer to number 3, for example? And then we've got that randomness coming in. So it's not always just the best students who are answering. And then with this, what you can do is, let's just think, is it best then to put this, when you've asked somebody, do you put it outside the pot or inside the pot? A lot of people say outside, so you don't ask them again. I put them inside the pot because then, if I ask Pedro, then Pedro can fall asleep because he thinks I won't be asked again. If you put it back in the pot, Pedro has to stay awake. So think about that as well. You may want to use Mentimeter. I think some of you will probably be aware of that. That's a really nice app where students can use their phones and they can send in their answers. And that's a little bit more private than using the mini whiteboards. Okay, they can do that anonymously. And perhaps somebody could put that into the chat, that link for me, please. Another brilliant tool, digital tool, that you may or may not know is called Clickers. And sorry, I meant to bring an example of a Clickers. With this app, each student is given a thing, it looks like a QR code, and around the edge it says in very small letters A, B, C and D. And you ask a question, like a multiple choice question, and they, if they think that A is the answer, they have it so A is at the top. If they think it's C, they make sure C is the top. And each of them have got a different one, and they hold those up. And then the teacher has an app on their phone and scans across the classroom, and then it appears on the teacher's screen what everybody has done. So nobody else knows the answer, but you've got them all and you can also download them. It's great. So check it out. Check out Clickers. And so again, if somebody could put the link in the chat, that would be great. One last thing is wait time. Wait time means how long the teacher waits after asking a question before moving to ask a different person or giving the answer themselves. And you need to think that with students who are struggling, they need more wait time. So I think it's important if you ask a question to the whole class, it's important to ask a question, then say, okay, everybody wait, don't give me the answer yet. And then you nominate somebody. And if they're a little bit slow saying the answer and somebody else tries to jump in with the answer, again, just a minute and give them enough time. Really important, I think. Okay, and so I hope there are some ideas there that will be useful for you. I hope I didn't go too fast. I had so much I wanted to say. But I'll be very, very happy to try to answer any questions that you've got. So thank you very much.
Thank you, John. It was wonderful. You didn't go very fast. I was here just writing down ideas and taking some screenshots of your slides. That was fantastic. Thank you so much.
You're very welcome.
So we have some questions here for you, if that's okay. How can we assess students to know which ones have fallen behind?
Oh, okay. Big question. I think there are so many ways of assessing. And I mean, you're going to have assessment in your books. I'm sure that you've got multiple ways that you assess. It can be looking at their homework, it can be looking at their scores on activities they do. And I think it's going to be fairly obvious. Now, if you've got a really big class, if any of you are in a part of the world where classes are huge, I know it's more of an issue, but still, I think there's more help with assessment sometimes than there is with teaching. So I think there are lots of things that you can do there. You know, if somebody's not doing well on something, then you know that they're falling behind.
Right.
That's just the question.
Right, fantastic. Some teachers were talking about motivating their students or talking about big classes. And then I'm just going to sum it up in one question. How to motivate students to do flipped classroom activities?
That's a really good question. This is what people often worry about with the flipped classroom. What if they don't do it? Okay. And I think if you give a task, and you know those two sites that I gave you, PlayPosit and Edpuzzle, if they've got a task, that the answer to that comes through to you, their answers come through to you, so you know whether they've done it. So there's a kind of extrinsic motivation there, because you can tell them that they have to do it. But that doesn't mean they will do it. I'm wondering, you know, if it's that different from giving students traditional homework and them not doing it. Mm-hmm. I sometimes say to teachers, it's a teacher's job to give homework and it's a student's job not to do it, because we've all had this experience of students not doing it.
True.
So what we're doing with the flipped classroom is we're giving them that opportunity to catch up. And if they don't do it, they're going to find the lesson difficult.
Uh-huh.
And we can explain that to them and say, look, I'm trying to help you with this. But in the end, I believe that teachers can't always take responsibility for what their students do or don't do. We do everything possible to try to make things engaging, to try to make them clear, to give them reasons to do it. But finally, it's got to be up to them and they've got to learn that. So that's my answer.
Very good, very good. It's true, it is true. I think if they're interested in what the topic is, or it's an activity or a platform that they enjoy, maybe it'd be a bit easier to get them involved and to get them motivated, right? They need to be.
Yeah. I also think that, you know, we're still in a YouTube generation. Mm-hmm. So if they're watching the kind of, okay, not the same videos that they're watching out of class always, because they might not be educational. But if it's a medium that they're comfortable with, I think that helps. You know, this is a generation who watch a lot of videos. And so I think that really helps as well. And if you can find really engaging videos as well, perhaps with, you know, people or images and things that speak to them.
Topics, right? Topics that they're interested in. Sure.
Exactly.
Yeah. Fantastic. Well, thank you so much, Johanna, for being with us and for sharing your practical tips and platforms. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much for inviting me. Bye-bye.